Today, we will do the analysis of 2021 prelims questions from the history area. And we will see how many questions are direct kind of questions and how many questions require a kind of analysis. Okay, so if we are looking into the number of questions, we can see around 21 questions were asked from the history. And in that, you know, ancient India, medieval India, modern India. 3 questions from ancient India, 4 questions from medieval India, 8 questions from modern India, and 2 questions from art and culture, and 4 questions from current affairs. So entirely we can say that around 21 questions were asked from history this year. Yes. Now we will move into the analysis of the questions. The first question from ancient India. Which one of the following ancient town is well known for its elaborate system of water harvesting and management by building a series of dams and channelizing water into connected reservoirs? I am sure that you all are aware of this question and also aware of this answer, because it was an expected question, right? Because the Ramappa temple had become the 39th site from India added into UNESCO World Heritage Site list, and the Dholavira is the 40th site. So anyone who had done a very serious and good preparation, you can answer it with confidence that Dholavira is the site. And Dholavira is also the first Indus Valley site in India that got added into the UNESCO World Heritage Site. We were expecting the question, and UPSC had also asked the question. See here, Dholavira is the correct answer. And you might have read this article that was published in Indian Express. In this, they are describing in detail which all are the characteristics that enabled Dholavira's entry into UNESCO's list of World Heritage Site. See, here the city is divided into 3 parts, and also series of water reservoirs were there. Yes, here it's a very easy question, direct question, and you can make it correct also. Now, the second question. This is also from ancient India. Usually UPSC ask this kind of questions, they match the pair questions. But if you have analyzed the previous year, the status or the trend of the question, you might have noticed the questions will be like the site and the river, or the site and the present state. But here in this question, it's like the site and why they are famous, why those sites are famous. Okay. Anyway, first is Burza Hope and Rocket Shrine. I am sure that those who are done the serious preparation, they know that Burza Hope is famous not because of any rocket shrines, but it's a prehistoric site. It is a Neolithic site. And you might have studied in Burza Hope, the masters were buried along with their dog. So you can eliminate this option, that containing the option 1, the Burza Hope. Yes, the option A gone, option B gone. Now, you are sure that the Ganeshwar, it is known for the copper artifacts from the option itself, because the third option is there in the option C and option D. Now, if you are having the knowledge, the Chandraketugar is famous for terracotta art, then only you can attempt this question, right? We cannot take the risk. And here, the Chandraketugar, it is famous for the terracotta art. And the correct answer is 2 and 3. Yes, in this question, your knowledge matters. You can eliminate based on the Burza Hope. But if you don't know the terracotta artist from Chandraketugar, then you can attempt this question. Okay, yes, you can see the terracotta art from Chandraketugarh, which is located in West Bengal. And this Ganeshwar, it is located near Khetri mines in Rajasthan. So you are having a lot of copper artifacts from this region, that is Ganeshwar. Now, the third question. The question seems very big, but it's not that much tough. It's not that much tough, provided that you are having presence of mind in examination hall. Okay. From the decline of Guptas until the rise of Harshavardhana in early 7th century, which of the following were holding power in northern India? Which of the following were holding power in northern India? Okay, this is the question. See, students, even though you are not having clear knowledge about the time period, I am sure that you might have studied your ancient India through the map. You should have a good clarity of the political map starting from ancient India. There, you might have seen this map, even though you are not aware of the exact time period. You might have seen this map. From this itself, you can understand. See, all of you, please look in the map. There is Empire of Harsha, Empire of Harsha. When there is Harshavardhana's empire is there in the Pataliputra region, in the Magadha region, you can see the light Guptas, and in the Vallabhi region, you can see the Maitrikas, and in the Kanauj region, you can see the Maukaris. Yes. This map-based understanding is very necessary and very essential. Whenever you are studying Gupta period, look the map of Gupta period. Whenever you are studying the late Gupta period or the post-Gupta period, it's essential that you should have an understanding when the Harshavardhana was ruling there, who were contemporary to Harshavardhana in the northern part as well as in the southern part. Now we will again look into the question. Okay, see here, you all are aware that this Harshavardhana belongs to Pushyabhutis of Daneshwar. It is his family only. So definitely Pushyabhutis of Daneshwar should be there in your option. Now you can eliminate option A because that does not contain our Pushyabhutis. And you can eliminate option D because that also does not contain option 3. Now you are left with option B and option C. From itself, you can understand that option 4, Maukaris of Kanauj, they were contemporary to Harshavardhana. Yes, 4 is correct. Now you have seen from the map that the Maitrikas of Vallabhi were there, and the Guptas of Magadha or the Light Gupta were there in the Pataliputra region after the decline of the main Gupta Empire. Yes, it's a map-based question. It's a map-based question. The correct answer is B. Even though you are not aware of the time period of Malvas of Paramaras or the Yadavas of Devagiri, here the UPSC is just checking that whether you are having the map-based understanding of the ancient India. It's very essential also in solving some of the questions of ancient India. Chronological-based understanding and map-based understanding is very essential, and it requires your presence of mind, and it's an easy question if you are having good clarity of ancient India. Now we have discussed every questions that were asked from ancient India, total 3 questions. Now moving into medieval India. Early the candidates were of the opinion that no, now the UPSC is not asking that much question from medieval India. We can skip the medieval India. But from 2019, you can see the UPSC is reversing the trend. Now it's also asking from medieval India. This it's not advisable to skip any area completely. Okay, this is the first question from medieval India. It's a kind of transition period. We can call it as early medieval period because this question is from 8th century. a writer Bhavabodhi. Okay, so the question, with reference to the history of ancient India, Bhavabodhi, Hastimalla, Shemeshwara were famous. They were famous writers, that is playwrights. They were famous playwrights. Here also knowledge matter. If you are having knowledge, then only you can give the answer. Here based on any guess, you cannot eliminate any option. And Bhavabodhi, he was a famous writer under the Varman dynasty of the Yashovarman during the 8th century, during the 8th century AD. And his most of the time, his works were equated with the works of Kalidasa. Works of Kalidasa and Uttara Ramacharita, it was one of his important work. And the Hastimalla, he was a Kannada poet, and Pura Purana is one of his famous work. And here the answer is they were famous playwrights. It's a kind of question that require your knowledge. Without knowledge, we cannot answer this question. Now, the second question from medieval India. See, here we cannot say that this question is completely out of the content. It's there. This content is directly given in your Satish Chandra. This content is directly given in your Satish Chandra. And see, in medieval India also, whatever history you are studying, whether ancient or medieval India, that chronology-based understanding, the time period-based understanding, when Vijayanagara Empire was ruling the South India, who were ruling in the Northern India, the Krishnadevaraya was contemporary to which ruler in the Northern India, that kind of understanding is expected, already expected from us. Okay, now we all know that Vijayanagara Empire, very important topic from medieval India. Okay, we will start from the third statement. It was during the reign of Devaraya II of Vijayanagara Empire, Vasco da Gama reached the coast of Kerala. All of you know, Vasco da Gama reached in 1498. Okay, now even though you do not know the exact timeline, I hope you might have at least noticed that the Vasco da Gama was reached during the time of the Salwa dynasty. During the time of the Salwa dynasty, you can eliminate option D, option C, because it was not during the time period of Devaraya II of the Vijayanagara. Okay, now you are left with option A and option B. From the options itself, you got clear that the first statement is correct. The first statement says that it was during the reign of Iltutmish that Genghis Khan reached Indus in pursuit of fugitive Khwarizm prince. Yes, this is correct, which is clearly given in your Satish Chandra in the chapter Delhi Sultanate during the reign of Iltutmish, directly given in the Satish Chandra. That means the first statement is correct. Now the second statement, it was during the reign of Muhammad bin Tughlaq that Taimur occupied Multan and crossed the Indus. It's incorrect. This is also given in the Satish Chandra under Tughlaq dynasty, Delhi Sultanate chapter. It was during the reign of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. No, even though it was during the time period of Tughlaq dynasty, it was after the death of this Muhammad bin Tughlaq. The death of Muhammad bin Tughlaq was happened around 1350, and the Taimur occupied Multan and crossed the Indus during the 1398. That means the second statement is incorrect. And the first statement is correct. Yes, the Taimur occupied Multan and crossed Indus in 1398. You can see the time period of Muhammad bin Tughlaq and also the time period of the Salwa dynasty that matches with the Vasco da Gama. Okay, it's a kind of tricky question, but if you have done enough revision based on the already existing knowledge from the Satish Chandra, you can answer this question by doing the elimination. Now, the third question from medieval India. Yes, we were studying the Vijayanagara Empire and we were expecting some kind of easy question from the Vijayanagara Empire. And it's a kind of very specific question where your knowledge matters. And I am sure that some of you might have taken the risk here also by marking the D. Anyway, the correct answer is D only. And here, the question is regarding the position of women during the Vijayanagara Empire period. And see, they were expert in wrestling, astrology, accounting, soothsaying. Yes, they were expert in everything. Soothsaying means foretelling the future. Okay, here the correct answer is 1, 2, 3 and 4. No elimination guessing. No, it cannot be done here. It's based on the knowledge. And some of you might have taken the risk here. And see, here in the PPT, I have given an article that was published in Business Line. It's a very old article. It was published during the 2017. And in the article, you can directly see the women were excelled as astrologers, soothsayers, judges, writers, and the literatures. Yes, they were actively involved in administration and trade. It's based on the old article. Anyway, women of Vijayanagara Empire, they were excellent in different fields. This the correct answer here is 1, 2, 3 and 4. And definitely here, your knowledge matters. Now, the fourth question. Medieval India, fourth question from the medieval India, the last question from the medieval India. See, here, anyway, you will be having the knowledge, but here, the presence of mind matters. In this question, your presence of mind matters a lot. Here, the question is regarding division of the Mughal administration. The division of the Mughal administration, you have to write it in the ascending order. Ascending order. Okay, see, we all know the Mughal Empire, the administrative reforms were very important because if you are looking the previous year questions from medieval India, you can understand that UPSC had asked question about Ikta system, Zemindar system, Jagirdari system, offices of Mughal period. So it is expected from us that we should have a good clarity on the administrative system of this Mughal Empire. It's a kind of easy question, but the mind matters a lot. Sometimes you may read it as descending order. Sometimes you might have read it as descending order. But the question is asking you the ascending order in terms of the size. Okay. Now, you all know that the Mughal Empire was divided into provinces which were called as Subha. That means Subha is the highest division. Thus, you can eliminate option C, option D. Now, you are left with option A and option B. The lowest division, it is Pargana. That means the correct answer is option A. That means the correct answer is option A. Yes, this is the division of the Mughal Empire. And if you are out of your mind in the examination hall, then you will mark the answer as the C. Yes, in solving some of the questions, the presence of mind matters. And it's a such kind of question, which is direct from your content, the reading that you have already done with reference to medieval India. Now, modern India. Yes, definitely in the history, we are expected that most of the questions will be from modern India. And this year also, around 8 questions were from the modern India. Okay, and this question is asking regarding the constitutional developments. Constitutional development that will happen during the time period of British. And you all know that if you had analyzed the previous year question of the UPSC, most of the time the questions were asked regarding the Constitution Act of this 1909, the 1919, 1935. Yes, so we should have a good clarity on the reforms and the provisions that were made under these three acts. And it is given in a very elaborative and in a very good manner in the Lakshmikant. You might have read the part one of the Lakshmikant. Now, anyway, coming into the question, the first statement, the Montagu Chelmsford reforms of 1919 recommended granting voting rights to all the women above the age of 21. Here, the keyword is all. Also, that keyword comes with a logic. See, during that time period, voting rights were limited based on your property, based on your income. And can you expect that every woman were granted voting rights? No, definitely not. So you can eliminate the option A and option C. Now you are left with option B and option D. Government of India Act 1935 gave women reserved seats in legislature. It is clearly mentioned in the Lakshmikant. You can read the provisions of Government of India Act 1935, which is a very important act. In the mains also, you might have seen UPSC had asked once or twice regarding the Government of India Act 1935. It's very important that we should have a very good clarity regarding all the important provisions of the Government of India Act 1935. Yes, the second statement is correct because based on principle of communal representation, there were separate electorates and there were seats reserved for the woman. This the correct answer in this question is option B. It's direct and easy question. And there is also keyword which makes your this job of solving question easy. Now the second question from modern India. Second question. Very easy question. With reference to 8th August 1942 in Indian history, which of the following statement is correct? No need to think. The Quit India Resolution was adopted by AICC on 8th August 1942 in Gwalior Tank in Bombay. At Gwalior Tank in Bombay? Yes, at Gwalior Tank in Bombay. It's very direct question. Any serious candidate can answer this question without thinking too much. The second statement is related with August offer. The third statement, all of you know that Congress ministers were resigned much earlier, around 1939. And the fourth statement, Cripps Mission, that were happened in 1942 March. This the correct answer according to the question will be statement A, which is very direct question and easy question. Now, the modern India question third. Who among the following is associated with the Songs from Prison, the translation of ancient Indian religious lyrics in English? Okay, now here, most of you might have eliminated Jawaharlal Nehru and Sarojini Naidu because it's a kind of religious thing that translated. And when such kind of statement comes, the two persons will be in our mind from the options, that is Bal Gangadhar Tilak and the Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. Bal Gangadhar Tilak, he was repeatedly in news in the last year, and you might be having a understanding regarding the major works of Bal Gangadhar Tilak, like the Orion, the Arctic Home of Vedas, Gita Rahasya. And this Songs from Prison that was translated by done by the Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. Here your knowledge matters. With a complete elimination you might not be able to reach the answer, but I am sure that some of you might have taken the risk here either by taking the Bal Gangadhar Tilak or Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. And this is work of Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, and since he is our father of nation, we should have a 360 degree analysis of Mahatma Gandhi, which is important in the mains examination and nowadays in the prelims also. This we are supposed to have a knowledge about the major works of Mahatma Gandhi. Yes, here you can see the songs from prison, the translation of ancient Indian religious lyrics that was done by the Mahatma Gandhi. Now, the fourth question from modern India. Who among the following was associated as secretary with Hindu female school that later came to be known as the Bethune female school? Very direct question from an important area, that is socio-religious reform movement, which is important for your mains as well as for the prelims examination. Here also, like the Quit India Movement question, a direct question, no confusion, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, who had done a lot of works for the women's education, widow remarriage. The Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, he was appointed as the secretary of Bethune female school in 1850 by the Bethune. Okay, now here in the PPT, you can see the major works of the Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, and you should have a clarity on the works of the Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar because he is an important figure in the social reform movements. Now, going into the fifth question from modern India. In the context of colonial India, Shah Nawaz Khan, Prem Kumar Sahgal, Guru Baksh Singh Dhillon are remembered as? Direct, easy, factual question. The officers of INA. INA trial, INA agitation, very important event in the modern Indian history. Any serious candidate can directly give the answer here. And this Shah Nawaz Khan, Prem Kumar Sahgal, Guru Baksh Singh Dhillon, three from three religions, they were brought for the trial in the Red Fort. And you might have read regarding the INA agitation. This is a very easy question and very direct question which you can answer. Now the modern India, the sixth question. Nizamat of Arcot emerged out of the Hyderabad state. The Mysore kingdom emerged out of the Vijayanagar Empire. Rohilakhand kingdom was formed out of the territories occupied Ahmad Shah Durrani. The Nizamat of Arcot means the Carnatic state, and it was under the dependency of the Hyderabad state. That means the first statement is correct. If you know the first statement is correct, you got the answer. You got the answer, that is 1 and 2. And the second statement is also, correct because Mysore kingdom, that is Wadayar dynasty, that were initially vassals of the Vijayanagara Empire. Yes, the Mysore kingdom emerged out of the Vijayanagara Empire. That is correct. Now, the third statement, Rohilakhand kingdom, which is located in the western part of Uttar Pradesh, it was formed around 1721. And Durrani kingdom, that is formed by Ahmad Shah Durrani in the Afghanistan region, it was formed around 1741. That makes the third statement incorrect. We cannot say that Rohilla kingdom was formed out of the territories occupied by Ahmad Shah Durrani. That means the third statement is incorrect, second statement is correct, and the first statement is correct. That means the answer is option A. Now, in the first quarter of 17th century, in which of the following was were the factory or factories of English East India Company located? See, if you have analyzed the previous question, generally UPSC asks question in the modern India from the freedom struggle part or towards the freedom struggle part. But here, the question is asking nowadays, asking from the early medieval India, early modern India. You have already seen the previous question, that is from the early modern India. This question, it is also from the early modern India. Yes, we are supposed to have a now good clarity on the early part also. The early medieval India, the emphasis on early medieval India, you can see from the questions. Now, see here, the knowledge matters. No guessing will work. Here, your knowledge matters and broach. And by the here, the question is first quarter of the 17th century. That means from 1600 to 1625. And by this period, this English East India Company, they had established factory in the Broach region, Ahmedanagar region, Agra region, and we are not having anything regarding Chikka Kole. It is the anglicized name of the Srikakulam, and Trichinopoly, no. Here the first answer, here the answer is one only. Actually, in this question, your knowledge matters. The 1600 to 1625 in the Surat, Masulipatnam, Broach, Ahmedabad, Agra, English East India had established their factories. Okay. Now, the next question, that is the eighth question from modern India, the last question from modern India, with a reference to Madanapalli of Andhra Pradesh, which of the following statement is correct? Okay, now see, you are having option A, option B, option C, option D. Here you can eliminate at least option D, right? Based on your knowledge regarding Theosophical movement, Madame Blavatsky and Colonel Olcott set up headquarters of Theosophical Society first in Madanapalli. No. It was established at the Adyar. Yes, you can eliminate the option D. Anyway, you are left with three options: option A, option B, option C. And here the knowledge matters. Without knowledge, you cannot take the risk. That may leave you towards the negative mark. And the correct answer is Rabindranath Tagore translated the national anthem from Bengali to English here in the region from Madanapalli. It's a kind of tough question. Only we can eliminate option D. Still, we are left with the options, three options. So here knowledge matters for solving this question. Yes, well, we are doing the analysis of modern India. Some questions were very easy and one or two questions were tough, and other requires the presence of mind and also clarity. Now, it's a kind of unconventional question, really. Those who have seen this question, those who have solved this question, they might have felt that. This question is from St. Francis Xavier. Anyway, UNESCO World Heritage Site was in news in the 2021 because of our Ramappa and Dholavira. And we are studying this Basilica Bom Jesus because that is one of the UNESCO World Heritage Site. In that way, we are studying. And in another way, in the art and architecture, we will be studying modern architecture. Under that, this Basilica of Bom Jesus, it is an example of the Portuguese Iberian style of architecture. And there you might have read that it contains the mortal remains of the Saint Francis Xavier, the Basilica of Bom Jesus. And the first statement, Saint Francis Xavier was one of the founding members of the Jesuit order. Yes, definitely he came for propagating the Christianity. That means the first statement is correct. And the second statement, Saint Francis Xavier died in Goa and the church is dedicated to him there. See, Basilica Bom Jesus, that contains the mortal remains of Francis Xavier, that all of us are aware. But we may not be that much specific to think that this Francis Xavier was not dead in Goa. He was actually dead in China. Later, only his mortal remains were brought back to India. Now, that much knowledge we may not be having. And I am sure that most of you might have gone with the option D by thinking that the Saint Francis Xavier is dead in Goa. Actually, he's died in China. It's a tough question. It's a tough question because most of us will be thinking that he died in Goa. The Basilica of Bom Jesus contains his mortal remains, which attracts a lot of tourists to the Goa also. And Here, the second statement is incorrect, and by eliminating the second statement, you will get the answer that is option C, 1 and 3 only. The Feast of St. Francis Xavier that is celebrated in Goa in each year, that is a correct statement only. And here the answer is 1 and 3. It's a kind of difficult and unconventional kind of question asked by the UPSC. And see, this St. Francis Xavier, this was in news. You can see the news. The Archaeological Survey of India is doing the restoration of the St. Francis Xavier casket in Goa. Maybe because of that, this question was asked. Okay, now the second question of the art and culture. The second question of the art and culture, which one of the following statement is correct? If you have noticed this year's pattern, a lot of questions are like ABCD question, and that is also kind of asking which is correct. You might have studied, you might have seen the most of the questions are from history. It's a kind such kind of questions. Now, Ajanta Caves lies in the gorge of Bakora River. See, it's a very easy question. I would say it's a very easy question because it is expected from us to have a good knowledge of the Ajanta Cave. Because Ajanta Cave, it was repeatedly asked by the UPSC in the previous year also. You might have seen the questions of Padmapani Cave, the sculptures of Ajanta Cave like Mahaparinirvana sculpture of Buddha. It was already asked by the UPSC. And you might have seen the trend of the UPSC where UPSC is mixing geography with the history, the region, their river, their location, present state. Okay. Here, Ajanta Caves lies in the gorge of Bakora River. It's a correct statement only. And it is clearly given in the Nitin Singhania also. Yes, it's a very basic level knowledge that Ajanta Cave is lies in the gorge of Bakora River, directly given in the Nitin Singhania. Anyone who had done Ajanta Cave in relationship with the Indian architecture, rocket architecture, in relationship with the cave painting, they can give the correct answer that Ajanta Cave lies in the gorge of the Bakora River. Now, the current affair question. First, consider the following statements. First statement, 21st February is declared to be the International Mother Language Day by UNICEF. Here actually, knowledge and the presence of mind matters. Because even though you know that UNESCO is declaring International Mother Language Day, sometimes we may read UNICEF as the UNESCO under anxiety. Yes, here the correct answer is first is incorrect. The first statement is incorrect because it is declared by the UNESCO. Now, the second statement, demand that Bangla has to be one of the national languages was raised in the Constituent Assembly of Pakistan. Yes, it was raised in the Constituent Assembly of Pakistan when Pakistan decided Urdu as the single national language day. There was agitation for making Bangla as one of the national language. An idea of celebrating International Mother's Language Day, Mother Language Day, it was idea of the Bangladesh. That means the second statement is correct and the option B is the correct answer. Here, your knowledge and the presence of mind matters. Now, the second question from the current affair. It is a circular. It is regarding the Chausat Yogini temple situated near Morena. It is a circular temple built during the reign of Kachpakadha dynasty. And the second statement, it is the only circular temple built in India. See, here there is only option, only. And it also comes with a logic only, right? This keyword. It's the only circular temple built in India. Don't you feel it's a kind of extreme statement? You might have seen the past trend of UPSC also. Where such extreme statement comes, you can eliminate. You have to take the risk here. Yes, eliminate the option 2. It's a very easy question. Just you should be able to write the take the risk based on the logic. It's not logical that it will be the only circular temple. And the correct answer is 1 and 4. The third statement, it is meant to promote the Vaishnava cult. No, it's related with the Yogini cult. And you can also see the ideas related with the Lord Shiva in the Chausat Yogini temple. And the fourth statement is correct. See, it was in news in 2019 related with the design of parliament. Anyway, the parliament building was in news for the last 1 or 2 years because of Central Vista project. And this was a news that is published in the Financial Express, the temple which inspired design of Indian parliament, that is Chausat Yogini Mandir. Okay. Now, the third question from the current affair, here definitely your knowledge matter. It is regarding Midakshara and the Dayabhaga system, the two schools of Hindu law. And here the correct answer is two only. Correct answer is two only because here knowledge matter, your knowledge regarding Midakshara and Dayabhaga system of law. This was in news in the current affair. Because of a judgment, Supreme Court judgment regarding the inheritance law under the Hindu law, the inheritance rights of the woman under the Hindu law. It was in news in August 2020. This most of the current affair websites, they have covered this Midakshara and Dayabhaga system of schools of law, the laws related with the property rights, right? Thus, now the Midakshara, it is practiced in entire part of India except in the Bengal and Assam. There it is Dayabhaga system. And in Midakshara system, you will be having son and everyone will be having right to property by the birth itself. But in the Dayabhaga system, you will be having the right to property only after the death of your father. This is the basic difference, but it's if you have covered the current affair very well, if you have noticed that judgment of the Supreme Court, then this question can be answered, that is Midakshara and Dayabhaga system of the law. Now, the last question from the history, that is, with reference to India, the terms Halbi, Ho and Hui pertains to. See, here, even though it's a ABCD question, based on your knowledge of art and culture, you can eliminate some of the options, right? You have to trust your knowledge here. Prehistoric cave painting. I am sure that you might have done prehistoric cave painting very thoroughly, where we have studied Bimbedka cave painting and other examples. We have not come across Halbi, Ho and Koi, right? Now, dance forms of Northwest India. No, we have studied classical dance forms, the folk dance forms in the art and culture. There also, we have not come across anything regarding Halbi, Ho and Koi. Now, you are left with the musical instruments and tribal language. But with the general sense also, the Halbi, Ho and Koi, more than being musical instrument, it's a kind of tribal language. You can give, you can attend this answer, attend this question based on the residual knowledge that you are having. You can do the elimination and come to the answer. It's an example of the tribal languages that is spoken by different tribal groups from the eastern part of India, Halbi, Ho and Koi. You might have seen the question related with Kalaripayattu that was asked from art and culture. It was also a kind of four question with similar kind of options. Okay. Now, yes. See, anyway, this Halbi rappers of Chhattisgarh was in news. It was in news. You can see meet the tribal Halbi rappers of Chhattisgarh from the Bastar region. It was in news, but we might not have noticed that news. Anyway, that the statements you can eliminate based on the knowledge that you are having already. So the Koi language, Halbi language, Ho language, they are spoken by different tribal groups from the different parts of India. Now, if you are doing an overall analysis, I have told you around 21 questions were asked from the history. Here, the six questions were very direct and easy. The six questions, very direct and easy. Two questions, even though they are indirect, like the last question and like the Chausat Yogini temple question, you can get the answer easily by eliminating the keywords or by eliminating based on the knowledge that you are already having. Now, the indirect and tricky questions, the question based on ancient India map, the question based on time period, the question based on early modern history, they are indirect and the tricky kind of question that you can answer. So we can tell that around 12 question out of 21 question, you can get the answer based on the knowledge that you are having. But in 9 question, really your knowledge matters rather than other guessing, solving. Here in the 9 questions, your knowledge matters. If you are having the knowledge, then you can attempt. Either you can take the risk or you can leave the question unattempted. Anyway, I hope that you got some insights into the questions that were asked from the history in UPSC prelims question 2021. The insights that you had got from this session that you can carry forward in your future preparation also, and you can analyze the trend of the question paper being changing, and a good clarity matters, the presence of mind matters more than the knowledge. So thank you all. Have a good preparation.